Developed in 2016, Ratchet and Clank is an extraordinary 3D platformer with pixel quality animations. One of the game weapons is the Pixelizer. As described by the game, this weapon fires a burst of energy that blasts enemies back in time, a time when resolution was a lot lower. This weapon basically turns enemies into pixelated versions of themselves and bursts them into pixels when they get killed. So, how do we implement this effect in Unity? First, I set up a simple scene with a character downloaded from the asset store. Take a look at the description to know which asset I have used for this project. We create an empty object called Pixelizer, which will have a child with a camera component on it. This camera component will be disabled and configured to clear depth and to call nothing, which means this camera isn't going to render anything by default. We will have to tweak the camera's T position, mirror rect, and field of view later to make the result match as much as possible the size of the original character. Now, we're going to create a new component called Pixelizer Renderer, which will be attached to our Pixelizer object. This component will be responsible for rendering the voxels when the enemy gets pixelated. On awake, we get our camera component and create a render texture and a command buffer that will render the character to the render texture. This will be done in the function add command buffer to camera, where we will create a render texture with the filter mode set to point, so the image doesn't have any kind of blurriness. Then we create a command buffer and set our render texture as the render target. We get all the renderers from our character and add the draw commands to the command buffer. Finally, we add the command buffer to our camera. Since our camera is configured to render nothing, this command buffer will be all this camera is going to render. On update, we have to render our camera manually. If we draw the content of the render texture to the screen, we will see that our character is getting rendered as expected. Now, in order to render the voxels, we have to create a voxel buffer. This is basically a list of points in space that will represent a pixel of our image. Each voxel contains a local position and a UV coordinate. We take this opportunity to calculate the bounds of our new object. In order to get a better idea of how the voxels are going to look like, we render a grid based on the texture size and voxel size we have defined on our pixelized renderer component. We will use this voxel buffer as a parameter of our draw procedural call on update. Bear in mind that we haven't told the GPU what we have to render yet. We are just sending a bunch of data to the GPU. There are other options here. We can use draw procedural indirect, draw instantiated, or draw instantiated indirect. I have decided to use draw procedural because our data and data count isn't going to change, so there is no need to resend matrices from the CPU to the GPU every frame, or any need to recalculate the data with a buffer. Using draw procedural means that there is no vertex or index data available on our shader, so we will have to recreate the voxel in our geometry shader. So let's take a look at how our pixelated shader looks like. First, we have to declare our voxel structure. This has to match the alignment and size of the one we have declared on the pixelizer renderer. Second, we declare the voxel buffer, which we will set up before calling draw procedural. On the vertex shader, we get the local position from the buffer and read the color from the pixelated texture using the UVs from the buffer. On the geometry shader, we get the data from our vertex shader and create a voxel using some predefined arrays. These arrays contain the location of every vertex of the faces of the cube and the normals of each face. We calculate the wall position of every vertex and convert them to clip space and the normal to world space. All these positions get added to the triangle stream, and the stream gets reset every time we finish a triangle. On the fragment shader, we calculate some basic lighting and interpolate the color of the fragment from an initial color to the final pixel red from the texture. This will give the voxel an initial flash. We create now a material that is going to use the pixelated shader. This will be the material that we will use on the draw procedural call. Before calling that function, we need to set the path and provide the material with some needed data. We add a couple public functions that can be called from our UI in order to enable or disable the effect. When the pixelation gets enabled, we need to change the layer of all the character renderers to a specific layer that is not going to be drawn by the main camera. We also need to flag the skin mesh renderers to update when they are off screen and change animator cooling mode to always animate. Otherwise, our character won't animate since it will get rendered off screen. Finally, we enable the Pixelizer renderer component so update gets called. As an additional step, we rotate the Pixelizer renderer on update to make our child camera to match the main camera direction. Now, we should have our pixelated camera fully rendered. The last step is to make the character voxels explode when the character gets killed. For this, I have used a particle system that I have attached to the Pixelizer object. When the character gets killed, we read the texture back from the GPU and read all the pixels storing the voxel wall positions and their color. This is a costly operation, but luckily, the texture size in our case is small enough to get away with it. Having the voxel positions and colors, we can initialize the particle system. First, we emit the needed number of particles, get them from the system, set their position, color, and velocity, and set them back into the system. I've selected a couple options on the particle system like collision detection, material, and color during lifetime. Stealing some sound effects from the original game, this is how it looks like. All the code will be available on GitHub, so if you are interested, find the link in the description below. Remember to like, subscribe, and leave a comment with which game effect you would like to see next. Thank you for watching, and see you in the next video.